meeting to order on this, the fourth day of February 2008, to conduct all business which will be properly brought before the body. First order of business will be our invocation by Mr. Hall, and then I ask you to remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you today with thanksgiving. We appreciate the opportunity we have as free people to meet and discuss the needs of our community and to make rules for the governance of it. We ask our Father that you be with the members of this board, guide them in their deliberations today so that their actions and all things said and done here would be pleasing and acceptable to you. We ask our Father you would be with those who hold positions of authority in our state and our nation, that they may guide it, that it be a guidepost of fairness and freedom for the whole world. We ask our Father a special blessing on the members of our military, particularly those serving in positions of peril. Allow them to perform their arduous duties with dignity and honor, and hasten the day when they can return home to their families. These things we ask in your holy name. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, and indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Now recognize Mr. Joe Cherry for the presentation of the Employee of the Month.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the Employee of the Month Selection Committee has selected Nancy Baroni of the Lee County Office of Emergency Management and the Fire Marshal's Office as Lee County's Employee of the Month for February 2008. Ms. Baroni has been employed with Lee County since April 2004 and currently serves as an administrative assistant to both the Emergency Management Director and the Fire Marshal. As an administrative assistant, Ms. Baroni has coordinated emergency exercises involving over 10 different agencies, consistently ensured a positive working relationship with county, municipal, state, and public stakeholders, served on the Human Resources Committee for orientation, and assisted with the 2007 Employee Appreciation Luncheon. Her professionalism and commitment to the goals of the Office of Emergency Management and the Fire Marshal's Office were particularly critical during a time when the Emergency Management Director's position was vacant, as well as during the transition to both a new EM Director and Fire Marshal. Ms. Baroni has established herself as a critical asset to our community. As stated in her nomination, Nancy consistently goes above and beyond her job description. She provides many value-added services to ensure the community is provided the best service possible from the Emergency Management and Fire Marshal's departments, which are truly dependent on her interest level and professionalism. The way she supports both departments is not something that can be trained or coached, and the way she performs her duties shows that she enjoys her job and enjoys serving the public. Ms. Baroni is a longtime resident of Lee County and has two sons. The committee felt that based on the recommendation and Ms. Baroni's dedicated and loyal service to Lee County, she should be awarded Employee of the Month. Therefore, the committee respectfully asks that you join us in awarding Ms. Nancy Baroni Employee of the Month for February 2008 in recognition of her service and commitment to the citizens of Lee County.
Yeah, I'm speaking you to it. This is truly a great honor, and I feel very fortunate and very blessed to work with so many wonderful people every day, especially my coworkers. Thank you.
Hey, if you come forward, please. First of all, we have a star award for you that you can take home or put on your desk or do whatever you want to do. We also have a certificate, Employee of the Month, February 2008, Lee County Government. recognizes Nancy Barone for going above and beyond regular duties to be an outstanding employee. And I also have some items here. First of all, a day off with pay. Also, a certificate from John Stusa, and one for the movie gallery, and also one for Coca-Cola products. So on your day off, you can eat and drink. I would also say that I used to work with her, so I know that she is an outstanding employee. Any additional items to be added to either the consent agenda or the regular agenda? Mr. Crumpton, I think you have one, don't you?
Yes, sir. I need to add a request for a grant application to St. Luke's Methodist Church by the DSS director. She has two already in the consent agenda, and we need to add this third one for $500.
Right, we'll make that item L under consent.
Under new business, if we could discuss public comments from today's meeting and the 22nd, I would like to do that.
We don't have to add it when I get to you. When I get to you. I don't understand.
How we're going to proceed with what we're hearing from the public comments.
You can do that on the public comment section.
If there are any motions that need to be made, can be done there.
All right. Any other items? Do I hear a motion that the agenda be approved with that one addition, item F, under consent?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say no. It's so ordered. Now entertain a motion for the approval of the consent agenda.
Moved to approve.
With the addition of...
With that addition, yes, sir.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say no. So ordered. Now come to the public comment section of our meeting, and I would remind you that during the public comment section, you have 3 minutes. With the number that are signed up, I would hope that some of you may not take the 3 minutes. We have 30 minutes set aside for this, for hearing these comments. Mr. Hall will be the timekeeper, and we'll proceed now with Mr. Wade Childers.
Thank you. I have two questions I'd like to ask. In September of last year, September the 5th, you voted to put this taxes on the ballot. What happened to that? That we have today? I mean, that's one of the questions. And it was passed 6-1. Then you had it last 2 weeks ago. And I don't know what happened then. It wasn't passed then. And that's just what I'd like to know. I mean, Do you vote on something and don't know what you're voting on, or what? I'm not being disrespectful, I hope I'm not.
Well, you're true that the motion was made and passed 6-1 concerning the putting the tax on the May ballot. However, in order for that motion to be official...
It was May, passed in May.
In order...
To May, it would be on that to May of next...
In order for that to be official, though, a resolution has to come from this board to the Board of Elections. So there's another step that has to take place before it's official.
That was one of my questions.
Right.
That how did it come up two more times, and you voted it 6-1 last then in September. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jordan. Recognize Mr. Bob Joyce.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. On behalf of the Sanford Area Chamber of Commerce, I'm here to speak in favor of placing the quarter cent sales tax before the voters of Lee County. And I'd also like to speak this morning in favor of dedicating the revenue from this small portion of our sales tax to education needs. We understand, of course, that the specific wording of the ballot was prescribed by the General Assembly, and that wording prohibits a specific indication for the uses of this revenue stream. However, I think the needs for educational facilities in our community are so great that the citizens should know that need will be met, and I think that by communicating that need and the use, it will help the voters make a good decision. Our Board of Directors has spent considerable effort in 2007 and will continue in 2008 to generate a discussion in our community on the issues of growth. Studies show that based on projections by the Census Department and even by our own folks here in the county, that in the next 10 years we will most likely be ranked in the top 10 fastest growing counties in the state. And if this occurs, we know that our infrastructure will feel the weight of that growth, roads, water and sewer, and school buildings. And those school buildings will be needed, and we need to begin planning now. Our survey of real estate professionals reported that schools were the number one issue mentioned by prospective newcomers to our community. So why the sales tax? We believe that the sales tax is fair and equitable. Recent studies show that the sales tax is not as regressive as once thought, and I'd be glad to share that information further, but in the interest of time, I'll cut that part short. In particular, in Lee County, our retail sales collections per capita, according to the U.S. Census Bureau, equal $13,333, and that is 30% larger than the state average of about $10,600, and the national average about $10,615. So I think we can see that we have a large retail sales base here. We believe that we can afford this quarter of a penny, that it will be easy to budget, and that the revenue stream is predictable. The Chamber of Commerce would be opposed to the real estate transfer tax, which, in the opposite, is unpredictable, narrowly focused, and unfairly targets property owners. I have spoken to lots of our members about this. Of course, our main concern was large merchants who sell big ticket items who would be impacted by sales tax. I talked with furniture dealers, appliance dealers, and so forth, and they are not opposed to this sales tax. I talked with industrial managers. We did an informal survey, and they are not opposed. And they relate to me that one of their paramount concerns is the ability to attract and keep good employees, and good schools are an absolute key for them. So, in conclusion, this board has been very successful in balancing the needs of our community, proper planning and a fair tax rate. You've been very far-sighted. We look at projects such as the airport, cooperative extension, and so forth, and we applaud your leadership and encourage you to continue. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Joyce. I was going to do it at the end, but some of you may have to leave, so I'm going to ask Ms. Minard to present a PowerPoint to you at this time.
Do you need the board members some copies? It's the same one we got the last week.
Right. Okay. We've put together a comparison of the quarter percent sales tax and the land transfer tax versus the property tax revenues. Excuse me. The quarter percent sales tax for the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners would produce approximately $1.5 million for us in a year. Property tax equivalency based on the current tax base would equate to 3.47 cents. In other words, it would take 3.47 cents added to our current tax rate to produce an equivalent amount of revenue that this quarter percent sales tax could bring in. For a $100,000 valued home, the property tax bill would increase $34.70. The estimated debt capacity from this revenue source is $38 million. What that means is with this revenue source, we could potentially issue up to $38 million and pay the debt service on that based on current numbers. Now, that does not anticipate any tax impact from the operating expenses or anything associated with issuing that debt. That would just pay for the debt service on the $38 million debt. The 0.4% land transfer tax is estimated by the Association of County Commissioners to produce $1,135,000 annually, which would equate to 2.6 cents in property taxes. So home valued at $100,000, their bill would increase $26 to bring in the equivalent amount of revenue. The estimated debt capacity from this revenue source would be $25 million. Any questions?
Thank you.
Back up to the quarter cent sales tax.
Yes, sir.
That looks like, what, 3.5 cents?
Yes, sir.
It would take to generate. And if we did not pass that quarter percent sales tax, that 3.5 cents, if it were to be generated, would probably come solely from your home.
Right.
What it amounts to.
Right. We have, the county has very limited sources of revenue that we can control, and property taxes are the main one that we can raise or lower. So it would be hard to come by that type of revenue without being a property tax increase.
So if we were looking at a 3 cents increase in our property tax and we had this money available, we would be able to defer the increase on the property tax.
For debt service.
Correct.
We are not speaking to operating expenses at all.
But just debt service.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Manor. Recognize Mr. Richard Hayes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Mr. Chairman, Board of County Commissioners. The need continues to grow. It presses upon us all to take down, renovate, and rebuild the sagging, leaking, and generally subpar physical plant of Lee County High School. The situation is recognized and discussed by a growing number of parents, students, and informed citizens of the county as disgraceful. It seems to me that the time is right for you to act decisively, even courageously, to change this picture from rhetoric of unfortunate, regrettable, unaffordable, to can do, must do, and will do. This problem is not going away, and it will become more expensive and more divisive if allowed to continue. In short, it has gone on year after year after year, far too long, but I am confident that you are aware of this. As our elected county governmental leaders, will you please lead and help to set in motion a positive and timely rebuilding program for Lee County High School? Please resolve to place on the May primary election ballot for voter approval a quarter percent local sales tax, now available to Lee County by state law, to be dedicated to the rebuilding of Lee County High School. This will help to reduce, perhaps eliminate, any further risk that something catastrophic could happen to any of our students or faculty. A safer designed and better equipped high school campus will be a long-lasting asset to Lee County and a more conducive environment for higher academic and athletic achievement for all students. Honored commissioners, this is not just about you. It is about all of us who are responsible for the framework of our local society. It is about values and most especially about the future place of education for 1,385 students, the seeds of our future, and the 166 teachers and staff who presently occupy Lee County High School. Thank you for your attention and unequivocal positive action.
Thank you, Mr. Hayes. Jonathan Williams.
Mr. Chairman, Jonathan Williams, I think the last time that I was up here, I think I owe you guys a apology. I may have stepped over the line and may have got a little boisterous about what I feel. I just feel compassionate about the people in Lee County and especially about taxes. If you look at our nation, where it's going, we're being taxed to death. Again, those people below $30,000 a year, they can't take the burden. In the paper, it read 28 out of 34 counties opposed no to the taxes. That should tell us something. Our education system, we have four elementary schools, or four new elementary schools, one middle school and one high school that's new. I think that our education should be put on the back burner of the stove, because every time that we see something in the paper, it's either about the Democrats and the Republicans fighting in this county or the nation, or it's about education. And we're missing the real issues of what's going on around us. I'm not saying that education is not important. Our kids are our future, but I'm saying put it on the back burner for a while. I read it in the paper also about incentives to big companies like Wyeth, where we spent $911,000, close to $1 million on them for them to maybe cut 10% of their employees. That's 140 families in Lee County and their families that may be affected by that. Why didn't that money go to the schools? We had an election last week about alcohol. Why didn't we have that in May? We could have saved that money. There's only four or five stores in the county that could sell beer or wine. That's not going to affect nothing in this county. All that business goes out of the county because they're going to go somewhere else to get beer and wine. I think there's a trail that's been mentioned in Lee County. Just in the paper the other day, they were talking about a trail around Jordan Lake where the gay people has taken over the trail. I oppose of this trail. There's a problem with our gay community taking over. Our kids don't need to see that. If not, look at what happened to Jordan Lake. That's going to take money. We read in the paper about people making comments about the Constitution of the United States and taxes. If our forefathers was to see right now how we abuse taxes and our Constitution of the United States, that they would probably get back in the grave again. As citizens of the United States, our duty is to defend and protect the Constitution of the United States. We're walking all over it. We're not defending it. We're abusing it. We're abusing taxes. We're abusing our Ten Commandments by taking prayer out of school, by saying, "In God we trust." That's the first commandment of the Ten Commandments right there. No other God. If I was to go to the carpenter shop right now and buy a Bible, I wonder how much taxes I would pay on it.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. And I recognize Amy Dalrymple.
Good morning. I'm here today to request that you put the quarter cent sales tax on the ballot for May. And also, I would like to request that in conjunction with that, that this board pass a resolution to commit the quarter cent sales tax revenue to the restoration and renewal project at Lee County High School, fully funded. Not just a Band-Aid, not just a portion of it, but let's take care of Lee County High School first. I know this can be done because Moore County, their county commissioners are doing that very thing for their students this afternoon at 4 o'clock. And I'd also like for you to consider at your next meeting if there would be any way that you could change the time. I've talked to a lot of parents and a lot of other concerned citizens. A 9 o'clock meeting and a 3 o'clock meeting effectively silences the public's voice. It doesn't allow the county citizens who want to be heard to be heard by this board. Very few people have the luxury of taking off from work and coming and addressing this board. So if you would consider that for your next meeting, especially in regard to Lee County High School and the needs of our students. Thank you.
Darryl. Mr. Ray Rhodes.
Mr. Commissioner, Mr. Chairman of the meeting and the commissioners, I'm here to speak today on, actually it's two different persons. First, I'd like to speak to you as President of North Carolina Home Builders Association. I think all of you understand, as well as folks in the audience, how we stand on the land transfer tax issue. We have spent much money in the past to fight this issue. We feel it is very discriminatory. And therefore, only a select few folks are paying the bill for everybody. And I think that's enough. I think you understand that situation enough that I don't have to bring any more up about that. But I'm here today also to speak to you as a Lee County citizen, as a builder in this town. I've been here since 1987. I have a six-year-old in school. And this morning he had to stay out of school because he's running a fever. And so we kept him out. Normally he sees me dressed in work clothes to go to work every day. Today he saw me dressed different. He said, "Dad, where are you going?" I said, "Well, I've got to go speak to the Board of Commissioners this morning." I said, "You know who they are?" He said, "Well, really, no." I said, "Well, they're the ones who run the county." He said, "All of Lee County?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "What are you going to talk to them about?" I said, "I'm going to talk to them about education." He said, "Education?" He said, "For all the kids?" I said, "Education for all the kids." So I want to speak to you about education in our Lee County system. Yes, our education program is lacking. We need more schools. We need to upgrade Lee County Senior High School. And I'm not going to speak long. I'm just going to tell you this. I'm asking from my heart to your heart to do the right thing. Put the quarter cent sales tax on the ballot. Put it on there in May. Make it an issue that we can use the money for the Lee County public school system from grades K all the way through 14. Let's do what we need to do for these children. They're our future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rhodes. Kathy Briggs.
Good morning. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to address you. 24 years ago next month, I came to Lee County to find a house. Every real estate agent that I dealt with took me past the Lee County High School campus, which was an award-winning campus and was beautiful, and it did affect our decision to live in Lee County. If I was taken by that campus now, I would run. I really support putting the quarter cent sales tax on the May ballot with a percentage pledge to the renovation of the high school. If the county's debt ceiling can be raised by $38 million if the sales tax is approved, phase one of the HITE plan, which is $16 million, would only take 42% of that figure, leaving a substantial portion available for other county needs, and there's a lot of county needs. We owe it to our students to provide a safe environment, a healthy environment, and a facility with the instructional capability to to provide them with the skills necessary to enter the workforce and to pursue higher levels of education. So please give us the opportunity to make this happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Bridges. Kathy Parker.
Hi. I wanted to speak to you all today also about my support for the sales tax. As a taxpayer in Lee County and as a resident, I expect for my leaders' decisions to reflect what I value. And I highly value education. And I'm very concerned because when I am on Lee County High School's campus and I see the degraded state of the facilities, I don't see my value reflected in those buildings. And instead, I see a school facility that is disadvantaging its students, the students at Lee County High School, because of the facilities that they attend are at a disadvantage to students in neighboring counties. They're also at a disadvantage to students even within the county. You can just visit Lee Senior and Southern Lee's libraries, the education centers of the school, to see the glaring inequity in the facilities. And I don't want to send that message. The message that I want to send as a Lee County resident and taxpayer is that I value education. So I would like the opportunity to send that message in a vote, and I hope that you all will put that on the ballot. And if that tax increase will adequately and equitably fund the renovation of Lee County High School, then I definitely support it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hart. Bonnie Boggs.
Good morning, Mr. Morning. Chairman and members of the board. I'm here today to speak as a parent, a resident of Lee County, and a teacher of Lee County Schools. I just wanted you to know that I do support the Lee County sales tax increase. I feel that this will give our county's leaders and our residents the opportunity to contribute to the educational needs of our children without the financial weight falling on just the property owners. Because even visitors that come to our county would also spend money, and that would also be a contribution. Lee County High School is in desperate need of improvements and renovations, and waiting is not going to make it go away. Just like at home, if you have improvements to do at home, they're not going to go away if you just keep waiting. As time passes, other schools will need repairs and renovations, and then they'll be added to the list, and then it's going to be more difficult to find funds for that. So again, I would like you to keep in mind the educational needs of the children in our community as you make your decision regarding the sales tax percentage increase. 0.25% is only a small price to pay towards educating our children for the future and to be productive citizens of our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Boggs. Sean Williams.
Mr. Chairman, Board of Commissioners, I stand in support of the 0.25% sales tax for Lee County. Stand this morning hearing the raise of 0.25% sales tax. Over the last 2 weeks, I've been in many businesses and asked, what are we charging for sales tax? Unbarely, I haven't heard 6.75%, but have heard 7% from most of our business owners in Lee County. Our sales tax percentage is 4.25% to the state, 2.5% local for 6.75%, but most businesses are saying 7%. So in actuality, if we go back to the 0.25%, that'll give the businesses exactly what they're charging, mostly anyhow, which is 7%. Will it benefit us? Yes, the county government will benefit by the 0.25%. Not only will the school system benefit, but across the board, $38 million is a large debt reduction. And we're asking that you support the Lee County schools. That's a portion of that debt reduction that could be used toward the Lee County schools. I heard one plan of 16, be in an area of 20-some-odd million for the Lee County High School to be fully done. School safety is a paramount situation we're in our nation. And I don't think Yes, educational classroom instruction is important, but children need to feel safe at school. They need to feel like they're secure. And right now, I don't think they feel secure at Lee County High School. Yes, educational opportunities are there, but without a safe environment, without school, good buildings, without the proper facilities, our students don't feel safe and learning goes lacking. Thank you.
Williams, and I believe I can congratulate you on being appointed to the school board.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Matt Garrett, Dr. Garrett.
Good morning, Mr. Commissioner and fellow commissioners. Appreciate the opportunity for citizens to come and speak. I speak to you as a citizen and the president of Central Carolina Community College. I just would like to say, most of what needs to be said has probably already been said. So I'd just like to say that I enjoy reading the letters to the editor in the Sanford Herald. And recently, there have been some interesting letters have been written in there. I'd like to respond. A respected citizen said that recently, I think over the weekend, wrote and said that if you gave the public schools all of the entire budget, they'd still want more money. Well, I just want to say that there's nothing that the county spends money on that gives you more return for your dollar. Every study that's ever been done shows that the better educated a group of citizens are, the less crime you have, it lowers the health care cost, it puts people to work, it lowers welfare expenses. In every way, the entire county benefits on every dollar that you spend on education. And not only the public schools have needs, but the community college, you're already aware of our needs. We've talked to you before. And so I would hope that as you move forward, you think about both groups. I'd also like to respond to a letter that was written by a good personal friend of mine. I won't call his name, but I don't quite think he meant what he said. He said that he felt that we need to let the users completely pay for education. The last time we did this in this country was about 1850. It was when private education was all that was available, and the people who could afford it got an education. But our country decided long ago that it works much better if everybody works together to educate the citizens. It benefits everybody. And so I think that what that writer would really say, I don't know if this is what he meant, but the fairest way to let all the users of education help pay for education would be the quarter cent sales tax. Because everybody that's buying is in some way benefiting from those who are getting an education. When the tide of education rises in a community, it lifts the entire community with it. And you can't do better as a board than to promote education. It will put your workforce to work. It will raise the standard of living. It will put wealth in the pockets of the people. And so thank you for considering this position so carefully. Please support the quarter cent sales tax being on the referendum. And hopefully, now I'm going to leave it to the board to decide how to spend it, but hopefully you would spend it for education needs from kindergarten through associate degree at the community college. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Garrett. Lloyd Kent.
Thank you. Here representing the Parents for Parity. I spoke to you several times on the issues. I'm not going to take a lot of time here today. We endorse a quarter cent sales tax. We would like something to be tied to it so the renovations at Lee County High School don't get football behind some new elementary schools and renovations of the two middle schools that are going to be pressing from the public also, as we mentioned earlier in our comments. So we'd like you to endorse the quarter cent sales tax and earmark a portion of that, those funds, for Lee County renovations of the high school. I think you've heard that loud and clear here today from the citizens that spoke. And we would like to echo what Amy said and try to have an open forum some other time so more parents could be actively involved and get in front of you so you could see the needs at Lee County High School because they're real. They're not going away. This has been an issue for many, many years. And anybody that has kids in the elementary school today, start this project within the next 12 months, all those kids will go through that high school and be in such poor shape by then that there will be some liabilities placed. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kent. Charlie Spivey.
Good morning.
Morning.
I've been involved in Lee County High School for over 30 years. 4 years as a student from 1969 to 1973, and 28 years as a teacher and coach. Being able to teach it and coach at my alma mater has been a dream come true for me. Teaching and coaching baseball are my passion. I truly believe that being the baseball coach at Lee County High School is the best high school baseball job in North Carolina. We want for nothing. We have arguably the best stadium and field in the state of North Carolina. We have any type of equipment we need. A beautiful locker room, beautiful uniforms, you name it, we have it. We have all this because the people in this town have donated their money, their time, their equipment, and materials to make it all happen. Because of this, and some very good players, we have competed very successfully over the years. Our players take the field with confidence because they realize that we have everything we need to be successful. Unfortunately, and more importantly, academically, we compete on an uneven playing field. We do not have the necessary facilities or equipment that we need. Our facilities haven't changed much over the years or kept up with modern technology. We are here today as a staff because the most important part of our jobs is the kids that we teach. It's definitely not about us. It's about our kids. Our jobs as teachers is to give our students at Lee County High School the best possible education. And one of the most important responsibilities you have as commissioners is to find a way to fund public education. We're here today as a staff asking you to find a way to fund our renovation project so academically we can compete on a level playing field. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Coach Spivey, and I think the success of the program is because of Coach Spivey as far as baseball is concerned. Reggie Peace.
Good morning, Board. I come today to speak to you to talk about increasing the support and the sales tax, and I also come to speak to you as a teacher, coach, and a parent that had kids go through Lee County High Schools. If you all would think, I don't know how many of you, I'm a guy from Oxford, North Carolina. I'm an old tobacco farmer, worked on a farm. And I think when our people, our students, come to PE class every day, I'm going to talk about just PE, the place where I work every day, that it's like during the summer, it's like working out in the tobacco field. The heat, it's not a safe place for a child to come to physical education, come to health class, to come to, you know, work out and do the things that you've got to do in physical education class. It's sad. It's not right for a student to come in out of the hot sweat, and he's got to change into a sweaty uniform. And you all know we talk about kids and obesity and wanting them to do the right things in class, and they have to come to an environment where, you know, you may as well be outside. Then we have athletics in the afternoon, the hottest part of the day. And boy, today I'm here to tell you that something bad's going to happen over in the gym with the heat. Be it a player, be it a parent coming to watch their son or daughter participate in an activity over at the high school. It's a very bad situation. And if it's not addressed soon, something bad is going to happen. And I would hate to see that happen in our town and our community. I think that's something that, you know, hopefully the board will think about and take into consideration when you're thinking about doing all the things that need to be done over at the high school. But it's something that needs to be addressed. It's a real situation. Not having air conditioning, football team, you can have a storm or something, and they can be told they can't go outside. They need to practice inside. It's hotter inside than it is outside. So there's a very serious issue there. And we hope that you will think about that in a compassionate way and do the right thing for the kids of our county. Thank you.
Thank you, Coach. Our half hour is gone. I have two more to speak, so I will let those speak. Steve Womack.
Good morning to you all. I come here as a 1969 graduate of Sanford Central High School, a 30 plus year teacher, former coach, athletic director, parent of two children who graduated from Lee Senior High School, and a taxpayer. And I come to ask that you do the right thing and put this 0.25% tax on the May ballot. I know that you're all aware of all the things from that we need in Lee County High School, from our gymnasium, also the athletic trainer. My office in the summertime is 90 degrees. Our football dressing room is 90 degrees. Could you imagine what do we take prisoners and keep them in buildings that are 90 degrees? This is where our athletes are. Our old gym needs bathroom, dressing room facilities, our fitness center, probably one of the most used facilities on our campus. Was one of our original buildings in 1951. It is air conditioned, but beyond that, the lighting, the flooring, the bathroom facilities are atrocious. The tennis courts are unplayable. Our tennis teams have to go and practice and play over at O.T. Sloan because of the damage that's been done weather-wise. We've spent money to try to repair them, which has been unsuccessful. We've at one time had approximately 2,500 students on our campus, and we were bursting at the seams. They've now been taken off our campus, where we have a nice number of almost 1,400 students, but unfortunately the seams haven't been repaired since those students have left, and we have lots of needs. I'm very proud of my high school, where I graduated, where I worked, and when we have I feel our high school is the front porch. When we have people come from other counties to attend our athletic contests, what they see is not what I would like them to see because of all the things that need to go that have been left undone. I will end with one thing. In November of 1963, I sat in old junior high school, which is what is now the Arts Center, and I watched on television the assassination of John F. Kennedy, and I sat there in horror and amazed. 40 years later, as a teacher in the classroom, September the 11th, my students and I could not see what was going on because we have no televisions. We have no television because our cable and our cable outlets could not accommodate television in our classrooms. Our students are at a disadvantage athletically and academically, and I ask that you do the right thing for our students at Lee County High School. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Womack. James, you'll have to tell me what your last name is, sir.
Coach Emerson.
Emerson, okay.
You don't know who I am?
Yeah, I know.
Morning, boy. Commissioners. You know, I worked at Lee County High School. I graduated from Lee County High School back in 1971. Where my office is located used to be the main building on campus. Well, it's still the main building on campus now, but the only thing now, we use umbrellas to go down the hall for rainy days. Bathrooms, facilities are terrible. I mean, it's just a bunch of things there that need to be done. You know, think about our homes, anything else, we want the best. We want the best for our kids. You know, I'm in education because of kids. The kids come up and ask questions all the time about our school. You can't answer the question a lot of times. You know, you just tell them to continue doing the best they can. Maybe things will get better. But, you know, over the years, like I said, I graduated in 71. I've been back there 25 years. And I've seen a little change on that campus. You know, we're talking about buildings with roofs that are sagging, roofs that's leaking. Stadium that's, you just hope nothing happens. But, you know, I go in every day, I pray that nothing happens at that school. You know, we started out, like you said, with about 2,700 students. Now we're down to about 1,300. We prayed every day that nothing happened on that campus. you know, and I'm talking about physical things. But now you worry about things such as buildings or somebody going to the gym calling one day saying somebody's had heat exhaustion or something of that sort. You know, we have a chance now to do something or just sales tax. I'm for it. I'd like a lot of to go to renovate Lee County High School because we need it. If you've been there, if you have nephews, kids, grandchildren, anybody there, they can tell you. When the kids taking tests in some room have to worry about, you know, they can't concentrate on taking a test or worrying about if that portal's going, when is that ceiling tile going to fall, and things of that sort. So, you know, I'm pleading not for me because I've been through it. But these kids, you know, they don't deserve this. These kids deserve better. Our kids need to be treated like any other kids throughout the United States. We need to be like any other kids that's in our conference. And the facilities, when they go somewhere, they even say our facilities match with anybody else's. Please keep that in mind. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Emerson. Coach, we had three coaches. That ends the public comment section of our meeting today. I appreciate all of you who took it upon yourself to make arrangements to be here and to speak. And I think the board has heard loud and clear what everyone has had to say, not only today, but at our last meeting. We will now take a 10-minute recess if some of you want to leave. Call the meeting back to order and move on to new business. We do not have any old business.
Mr. Chairman, in light of some of the comments that we received here this morning regarding, very specifically regarding the safety of the Lee Senior School, I think it's only fitting and fair that we make a request to the Board of Education to find out how they have dealt with those issues or had those issues on their agenda, as well as the overall preventive maintenance program that they have in place. Because this board does not have that responsibility. It rests solely in the hands of the Board of Education. And while I appreciate all the support I'm hearing for taxes, it's still a matter that I'm hopeful that many of these same people have taken to the Board of Education. And we can do that by letter from this board and through our representative on the school board.
Did we not request a report from the school board as far as the maintenance on the different schools?
I'm not aware of that. I have not made that request to them. I did request their annual budget. I do have their annual budget, which we made a copy and sent to commissioners. And I do have a copy of their annual audit. It doesn't detail specifically the maintenance expenses by school. So if we need a detailed maintenance plan, I'll have to request that from the superintendent.
I just think in fairness to this board and to the general public that there be a clear understanding of where that responsibility lies. And while our job is to appropriate the funding with the resources that we have available to us, it's the Board of Education's responsibility on that, on some of the issues I heard here this morning. And they do concern me very deeply. Some I thought was very, some very interesting comments.
All right, Mr. Crumpton, if you will
request sure that. Why do we need a maintenance plan? Or why do we need to know what their records are there?
Well, you were on that. Maybe you can tell me what you've done to offset some of the things we've heard this morning then.
Well, as far as F&T, it was not on that committee, but as you
I asked about the committee. Tell me what you've done.
We've got our as much as we can with the money we were appropriated when I was on that board. My point is, I don't know why we need to know what they've done. It's not our responsibility, as you just said. if there are safety issues, let the people address it with the Board of Education. We made that clear that we fund them their money. If how they spend that money is their job, not ours. So what good is it going to do us to know what they've been doing? We're not going to change anything.
Is that your position on the matter?
Now, I think they've done as good as a job as they can based on what they've had.
Well, you have an opinion, and you obviously have some inside information that at least I don't
have. More than you do about it.
Well, then I want to know more about it.
For what reason?
So that I'll know how it's being done and whether the appropriate use of the money is as intended or should be based on what I'm hearing.
And what can we do to change that?
Okay, we're not going to debate this issue.
We probably should. Obviously, this man has a totally different opinion of how and who uses money.
I think we give it to them and let them spend their money the way
they see. And hold no accountability?
In your words, we give them their money, how they spend it
and
is up to them.
And hold them to no accountability is what I asked.
No, I didn't say that. Let the public hold them to their accountability during the voting times.
I'm going to hold them accountable with my vote.
That's right. Not here, though. Not as a commissioner.
Yes, I will.
So we're going to withhold funding from them if they're not doing what we're supposed to do.
Those are your words, but yes, I will use my vote.
To withhold funding.
I will use my vote.
Again, we're not going to debate this issue any further. I am instructing the county manager to follow through on the request for that information and make the comment that individual commissioners have a right to request information from concerning any item of interest to the whole board or just to that commissioner. So,
Mr. Brown, can I just make a statement here? There's very few things that Commissioner Reeves and I probably will agree on, but he and I are pretty much on the same page with this. And one of the things that concerns me is we do have a fiduciary responsibility. That's our most important responsibility on this board, is the fiduciary responsibility we have to the taxpayers. And my concern is there are state statutes that say very clearly, they delineate the responsibility of funding for public schools. And I'm reading here from the General Assembly enacted the School Budget Control Act. And it says, to ensure a quality education for every child in North Carolina and to ensure that the necessary resources are provided, it's the policy of the state of North Carolina to provide from state revenue sources the instructional expenses for current operations as defined in the standard course of study. It's the policy of the state of North Carolina that the facility requirements for a public education system will be met by county governments. Now, one of the things that I want to see in that school budget is I think that the taxpayers have been very generous over the years because I think we're funding a lot more than school facilities and the current operating expenses. And I think that the taxpayers and parents need to take a look at, you know, how much more we're funding. And in the school board's defense, they're getting all these unfunded mandates about reduced class sizes, but no funding. But it's time we dig in our heels. I think it's something that the school board and this board can work together on and say to the General Assembly, do the job you're supposed to do. You fund the instructional things, we'll fund the facilities. And I would like to know, you know, I think it's very possible we could fund all of these things if we weren't having to fund other programs that we're not supposed to fund. So I want to see the data, and I want that information from the school board. And it's not to be an adversary situation. I think it's something we can work together on to bring about change at the General Assembly. So had to get that off my chest.
Moving on, new business, recognize Mr. Michael Watson for report and update on Sand Hill Center operations. And thank you for being patient, Mr. Watson.
Good morning. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. What I'd like to do is just take a couple minutes and update you on what's going on with Sand Hill Center and a little bit about what's going on with community mental health in North Carolina in general. I'm going to hit four or five different topics: our financial situation, talked a little bit about crisis services, some of the activities that we are involved in terms of new program development. If you look at our budget, we've just received our 06-07 audit. You should have gotten a copy of that. It went to our area board. It is an exceptional audit. There were no financial or compliance concerns. Our financial situation is strong. If you look at the first quarter of this year, we had revenues of $9.2 million and expenditures of $7.9 million. You will have our report for the July through December period, probably the next 2 or 3 weeks. What happens to us is we tend to earn some of our money a little faster earlier in the year. So this time of year, we're a little bit ahead, but that tends to kind of sort itself out as we move through the rest of the fiscal year. As I said, we have a strong fund balance. This year, we are appropriating about $800,000 to support our community access points in each county. So that community mental health center that provides crisis services and psychiatric services, a place where people can walk in that exists in each of our counties, this year that's being supported with an allocation of some of our fund balance. One of the biggest issues I think going on right now with us and in North Carolina in general is the whole issue of crisis services. If you've been reading the paper, you've heard an awful lot about state hospitals. There have been two or three problems. Broughton now West has been decertified for Medicaid and Medicare funding. A new hospital that was built in Butner had some safety issues. So there are some design issues with that that are now in the process of being straightened out. We have a new secretary in Raleigh, a guy named Dempsey Benton. I've been very impressed with him. He's a former manager of Raleigh and a very no-nonsense, straightforward kind of guy who has taken on some of the priorities that need to be addressed. One of the things he's done is delayed the closing of Dix Hospital until the spring with the idea that, you know, we need to get the rest of the state hospital straightened out and on board before he moves forward with closing Dix. It also looks like that they'll be keeping some beds open at Dix for use by Wake County. I wish I could get a few of those, but the Wake County commissioners are going to be paying for those. One of the real issues in crisis services has been the growth in admissions to state hospitals. And at Sandhills, reducing that number has been our focus. And I think I'm very proud of the fact that in the last 6 months, I think we've really seen some significant success. We're spending an awful lot of money treating people locally. We have very large contracts at First Health and Pinehurst where many of our consumers here in Lee County go. Sandhills Regional, Holly Hill and Raleigh. We're doing a lot of business with Moses Cone and High Point Regional so that we have psychiatric inpatient options for both adults and children. The impact of that, I think, has been significant. Since July, we reduced the number of admissions to state hospitals by over 300. That's a 45% reduction in the number of people leaving our community and going to a state hospital. That means people are getting treated closer to home. In addition to making sure that people have a local place to go, we're trying to work real hard at cutting readmissions, and I'll just give you one example of what we're doing. We've contracted with two private providers, and we have some good providers here. What they're doing is taking charge of everybody who's been committed to a hospital and is leaving it. And they basically got them for the first 30 to 45 days. And their job is to make sure they get hooked up with services, make sure they have a place to live, make sure they see a doctor, and make sure they get the medicine they need so that they get reintegrated back to a community and have less chance of returning, of being a repeat admission. I'm going to get a minute, I'll talk about some of the funding flexibility we've been given, but we're using that flexibility to really pay the providers to do the right thing. You know, one of the things we've struggled with in this new mental health reform is the whole privatization issue. It's how do you create the right incentives for people to give you the outcomes that you need for consumers and families. With these providers, we're asking them to do part of the business where you don't make money. You're doing all the travel to the state hospitals to see people. You're doing all the expensive upfront diagnostic work. And then you may not keep the consumer. We're saying, then you give them up to what's best for them. So what we're doing with those two providers is we're trying to contract where we pay them the difference between what they earn and what it costs. So we're subsidizing their operation with the idea that we're going to get the kind of outcomes we want by having fewer repeat admissions to state hospitals. We continue to devote a great deal of time and energy to, I can't describe it any better, just cleaning up the community support mess. About a year ago, the state put in place a new Medicaid service called Community Support. Providers rushed in and started doing it. You got $50-something an hour, whether it was done by a professional or paraprofessional, and it absolutely got out of hand. The services were authorized by Value Options, who is a state, big state contractor. It has become an $800 million service. It is the single biggest expenditure in the Medicaid budget. And that's reached a point that as I go to county commission meetings, what I'm hearing about is the 5%. And in some of my smaller counties where there's a lot of community support, it hasn't exploded here as much as in other counties. The 5% Medicaid on that money is really beginning to affect the community Medicaid budget. What we're trying to do is get that under control. What we've done over the last few months is we've reviewed over 1,400 records of consumers who are getting that service. We're finding people who didn't need it, and we're finding people who got more than they needed. Those reviews have led to, at least I've seen, between $5 and $10 million in payback requests from the state going out to individual providers saying, we think you owe this money back. So we're involved in a number of appeals and perhaps eventually court cases that will be associated with efforts to recoup money from providers. We're going to be doing a needs assessment in all of our communities, kind of looking at where things are, what gaps people see in the service system, and what can we do about it. So there'll be a public hearing in each county that will be advertised, and we hope very well attended. I mentioned a minute ago the whole idea of flexible funding. We've been selected by the state to participate in a project called single stream funding, and very simply what that means is instead of getting our money in 20 or 30 different pots, we're getting our state dollars in one pot of money. You know, traditionally, funding would come down for women with substance abuse who were pregnant, who might have had HIV, and that's a little bit of an exaggeration, but it would be in very small categories, which made it difficult to expend. What we've got is one pot of money, and we've got flexibility about how we use it. Doesn't always have to buy a unit of service. So we can buy medicine, we can pay for transportation to get people to services at times. We can help with housing. And we have more flexibility about what we do. We're paying providers to start services, to help them with the startup cost of bringing a new service that we want into our community. So I think this single stream funding is giving us the opportunity to look at our system and say, okay, how do we create the incentives in this privatized world to get what we want for our consumers? How do we generate services in our community? The final kind of service issue I wanted to mention is just that in January, a new requirement came out from the General Assembly around jail services. So what we are doing is meeting with each of our sheriffs in our, you know, all 8 of our counties, looking at a couple of things. One, there's a new assessment instrument that sheriffs are supposed to be using in terms of looking at the mental health needs of people as they are coming into jail. Two, there's a requirement that we review the booking logs, who came in. Because we want to know if any consumer we're serving came into jail. That lets us make sure that we know they're there, that they get medicine, and that they get hooked up with services. We're also funding a jail diversion program, which will roll out over the next few months. And that's a little bit of a different focus. It's really looking at who's there, can they be safely moved out into supervision and treatment as a way of reducing the number of people with mental health problems in jail. This requires a lot of cooperation among the jail, law enforcement, district attorney's office to make this work in a safe and effective way. But we're putting a big investment into this idea of jail diversion as we move it across our area.
Let me ask you a question in that area. Because in counties where the sheriff's department may be dispatching offices for more frequently than they have over the years past, the time that they're lost, is there any reimbursement from the state for that expense?
You're talking about transmitting?
Yeah, whatever it takes to.
Yeah, transporting involuntary commitments.
Right.
No. I think what we're trying to do is to make sure that two things happen. One is that once you end up in a hospital or access point, if somebody's decided you need to be committed, but there's a bed available. Mm. Because what's happening with Dix is it's closing about half the time to admissions. Mm. And there's a decent amount of time when Dix either won't take males or won't take females or won't take children. So you really want sort of two things going on, that there's a bed available and that it's as close as possible. For Lee County, the best option right now is to have a bed immediately available and have it in Pinehurst.
No, I agree and understand that. That's not what I'm asking about. What I'm asking about, and I know that in years past they have it, but if an officer is required to be with that person in transport for 10 hours, that's 10 hours the sheriff's department has no use.
That's correct.
No available use. So that's a loss to the county funding process and a loss to the sheriff's manpower. So in essence, for every time we have that situation occur, we've either got to go shorthanded or the sheriff comes to us for additional folks. So, and my question was, is there any provision in the state's reimbursement plan to take care of that? Okay, that's it, thank you.
Well, I think when a female is transported, there are two.
Yeah,
you have a male deputy.
You generally have to have a female present.
Right.
So I've seen them for 12 hours right over here at this hospital. So my point is, there's a loss that we have to pick up the tab for. And if you don't maintain, that's why we ask the sheriff's department to maintain a record. How much time are you losing for that purpose?
Okay, good. Just let me wrap up here, and I'll be glad to take any questions you might have. We continue to deal with issues around our provider network, making sure we have competent providers, that they are effectively monitored, that we have a very aggressive care management function, which means that for individual consumers, if you have a problem or something isn't going right, we have people in your county who can help you get that straightened out. And we're putting a lot of emphasis on communicating with consumers and families and the community around how this system works. A lot of concern about how do we create the right incentives to get the outcomes we're looking for. You know, we move more and more into a world where we're buying what we need for our consumers. How do we make that happen? Community support is probably the worst example of how you don't make it work. You know, we're gonna spend a lot of time, a lot of work cleaning that up. I think what we're also trying to do is develop alternative models about how do you get the right things? How do you create the right incentives? Thank you.
Okay, any further questions of Mr. Watson?
You spoke of a needs assessment that y'all were doing. Is that an internal needs? I mean, are y'all performing that yourselves or is a state coming in?
Well, it's something we're doing, and we're involving our Consumer and Family Advisory Committee. So those are people in the community who are either family members or consumers of service. We've got surveys being done of our provider community. We've got surveys being done of some of the stakeholders in each of our counties. And then we're doing a public forum to kind of give people the opportunity. We're also looking at data. I mean, one of the things we're doing is just looking at what's being bought in each county. I mean, what's actually happening, both in terms of what I buy with state dollars and what happens with Medicaid, and then what gaps are there in those services.
Okay. Any further questions?
Will those committees, the needs assessment, will those committees host public hearings, or will they be part of the public hearings that you hold?
Yeah, they'll host them.
Are we getting a copy of the schedule?
Yes.
You do that in each county?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Watson. Good report.
Thank you for your time.
Consider computing support technician 2 position, Mr. Strong. I believe that this position has not been before the Finance Committee. Is that correct?
This year it has not. That's correct. He made the request in last year's budget. It was not funded. He came to me with a funding plan that he could support the position within his budget, do some reorganization, which I encourage department heads to do. You know, if they can do things to make themselves more productive from within their department without asking for additional dollars, that's what I want them to do. So, you know, he came to me with a plan, and actually there's a savings by what he wants to do. So that's why I supported it, but it has not been to the Finance Committee.
But it will be a recurring expense.
That is correct.
I think we need to refer this to the Finance Committee and let you make your presentation to the Finance Committee, and they therefore will bring a recommendation back to us at the next meeting.
Sure. Okay. Yeah.
Do I hear a motion that we table this until the next meeting?
So moved.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say no.
No.
So ordered.
Mr. Chair, just for the record, I would ask that any more hiring from any department be referred to finance. You know, if we're going to run a loosey-goosey operation, then you don't need a finance committee. If the idea is that because a person can create a situation that looks favorable at the time, these are expenses that will be ongoing. And we have to have some checks and balances during tight times. We need them all the time, but especially during tight times. So I would certainly move and request that any hiring be referred to finance for consideration, and then perhaps even to the full board for discussion.
You make that just a motion?
For clarification, is this to replace existing positions as well?
No, you already have a mechanism in place for that. This wouldn't be a replacement, would it?
No.
Okay. So you have a
new position.
Strictly new.
Yes, we have a provision already in place for replacing people.
But are you saying this had no impact on the current budget? He was able to...
But it's a recurring expense.
And I haven't seen it.
I would have liked to have heard his presentation here, because...
You will.
You can still hear.
For the full board, because I'm sensitive to that. I've been in IT training for a long time, and I know that when you don't have the support people you need, how, you know, that can be a tenuous situation. So how soon will we be able to... Is this something that's critical for him? Are they getting a lot of help desk calls? And
yes, because he's supporting, you know, he's bringing on more and more departments where we're trying to eliminate the third-party contracts. So he's bringing on more work inside his department.
Did you read the request?
I did.
It's not like he doesn't have the support. He has a health desk that he uses now. So that's not the issue here. The issue here is we're moving from an outsourcing into an in-house reoccurring expense.
So obviously my position would be, whether I'm on finance or not, I want to talk about that before we accept that kind of situation. Because the next thing you know, a lot of the privatized operations that we may be utilizing will start coming back in-house. And then you'll start to see government grow again.
And I did note that the county manager had recommended the approval as presented, so I have a lot of confidence in John, and I think he probably vetted that pretty well.
I voted for him too, but they ain't anything do it.
For me, it's more of a procedure thing. I mean, I think all new hires should come before finance, because you've got a lot of business out there that are laying off people and cutting people left and right, and tightening their belts. And I don't see where a county government should be any different. It needs to everything needs to be scrutinized.
It would have been good to ask those questions as a whole body to hear, because I think.
Well, we'll have that opportunity.
Did we take a vote on the date?
It was on 5-1. It was 5-1.
Still got a motion on the floor.
A motion to have all new positions
Come
before finance before the
motion been made that all new positions be presented to the finance committee, and the recommendation come from the finance committee concerning those positions. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say no.
No.
5-1 in favor. 1 commissioner absent. Mr. Pascal has been excused for today. Consider resolution for the disbursement of 9/11 funds. County manager.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. We took this issue to the finance committee at their last meeting, and to bring everybody up to date, the collection and disbursement of all 911 funds in North Carolina changed effective January 1st. So instead of that, we had a wireline fund and a wireless fund. They've combined the two, and they're going to charge one flat rate for all service across the state. The General Assembly gave us a one-time ability to take funds out of the wireline fund balance and transfer it to the general fund. These funds are normally highly restrictive, difficult to use them for anything but the actual equipment that we purchased for 911. We saw this as an opportunity to move funds that were highly restricted to an area that's less restrictive, but we still want to use them for future emergency management or law enforcement type expenditures. But we wanted to get this transfer done before the short session, because there's a lot of heat back on the General Assembly to make these funds restrictive again. So we're trying to move along and move this to the general fund.
All right. Do you hear a motion that we take the recommendation of not only the county manager, but also the finance committee?
So moved.
Any further discussion?
I have just a couple of questions, things I didn't understand at the finance committee. So this $500,000 is coming into our general fund, and it just has to be, the other restrictions are to be used for public safety or emergency management?
That's what our resolution says, but actually I believe you could use it for anything.
So public safety, though, could be a sheriff's department. Could it be volunteer fire departments or not?
Yes, ma'am.
And emergency management.
Yes, ma'am.
And it doesn't have to be just the equipment. It could be training. It could be really anything.
That's correct.
My only question is, should we instead of 500, do, say, 700,000? And
there's just the 500 that we can transfer. Yeah, and then we still have 700.
Got greedy in
almost 800. Yeah, we almost got 800,000 left in the wireless fund, but we have to leave that in the reserve for 911. Good try.
I'm glad to see that these 911 funds are the distribution and use form is becoming less restrictive. In the past, we hadn't been able to do anything hardly with 911 funds except sit on.
Limited by statute at first.
Well, one of the concerns I do have, though, is to read this statute and all these acronyms. I kept going back to look at the glossary to see what these acronyms were, but the looks like the revenues, 53% of these funds going forward, once this new board is created, will be remitted back to the CMRS providers. Those are the commercial mobile radio service. So give me an example of a CMRS. Is that like a Verizon or a Altel, or
I'm gonna defer to the expert here.
I got a little nervous about the distribution proportion.
He knows all the acronyms and I don't.
Mr. Griffin.
Yes, thank you, Commissioners, and Eric Griffin, Director of Lee County Emergency Management. Yes, ma'am, you are correct. The CMRS are the commercial radio providers, such as Verizon and the telcos, telephone companies.
Okay, now they're going to include voice over internet protocol now.
That's correct. And that is going to expand the capability and the revenue stream. However, if I may, the unfortunately, this these funds, this opportunity through this most recent bill, which allows us to do the transfer, is our only opportunity to have a less restrictive. It is going, these new funds which will be coming in will be just as restrictive.
Now, the largest part of it's going back to the providers.
Yes,
I don't understand that.
Certain interest groups within the state legislature have advocated for that provision.
So only 40% of those funds are coming back to primary PSAPs, and I guess that's the folks that man that, hours?
Yes, those are, that is correct.
Seems like that should be reversed to me. The taxes should come back to where they're most used instead of going to the providers.
My professional opinion is that I would support that. However, that is at the state legislative level, and unfortunately we do not have a whole lot of advocacy. There's a great debate that goes beyond around the APCO, which is the American Professional Telecommunication, basically the 911 dispatchers and then the telcos, and it's a great debate. But
something else I didn't like about it is we can't fund positions with that. It seems like if people are going to be taxed to have the 911 service, that we ought to be able to use those funds for not only equipment and training, but for the people that man those 911 service.
That is actually the same as with the last funding restriction. So as explained before, there are a lot of the same restrictions are in place. However, the biggest advantage that I see with this new bill is, one, it gives us a one-time opportunity to shift the funds. Hopefully, the commissioners, with that motion, will limit it to public safety, and as well as allowing that we will be able to access the voice over IP, which is digital phone service like Time Warner is offering now, and Charter, and that will add more revenue streams to the pot. So as we transition from a wireline to a voice over IP or digital phone system, we should see at least maintaining or increasing revenue streams.
Does the county government pay a 911 service fee for all of our lines?
Yes, ma'am.
What is our total bill each month for 911 service fees?
I'd have to total that up.
So for every single phone that's used here in county government, we pay that 70 cent fee?
Yeah, manner.
I believe some of our lines do not get charged it. I'd have to go back and audit our phone bills to see. But it's not every single phone. It's a phone line.
It's, yeah, the phone line.
The number of lines coming in for county use.
At some point in the near future, I'd just be curious as to know, are we spending more than we're getting back? Okay, that was all my end. I still don't understand all this stuff, but I got the message. Special interest groups took care of their folks.
Yes.
Okay. Didn't get a vote on this yet. Okay, we got a motion on the floor. All those in favor say aye. Aye. Any opposed, say no. It's so ordered.
The sheriff's department will do this job?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
He's already been in to see me. And so is the city manager.
Everyone is vested interest.
Well, as I say, in the past, having had experience along those lines, those funds have been so restricted, you just couldn't, you're like pulling IT trying to get money to do anything.
This is a one-time.
Just sit there for years, didn't it, Ms. Winter? Okay. All right, that ends the new business. Go on to the manager's report. Update on CDPG project.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. We are moving along quickly. I have Karen Kennedy here if there are any specific questions. But we did get a letter from the town of Broadway to add some money to this project, a little bit over $20,000 they had left over in a project fund that they had. So we've added some money to that. So that we can do a housing rehab in the town of Broadway. We're opening bids tomorrow for 3 units, and we've already started work on one of the units. Be happy to answer any questions, but this is moving quickly. I wish all of these would move this quickly.
Well, we've got a time limitation.
Yes, sir, we do, and things are going well so far.
John, the only thing I saw was the list of contractors that said attached, and I didn't have those, so if I could get a copy of them.
And we do add, we are adding, so we're out, they are out actively recruiting to try to get more bidders.
Do you have any comments, Ms. Kennedy?
No, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I do have a couple other items I'd like to discuss. Mr. Rhodes did send us a letter and resolution from the Home Builders Association supporting the local sales tax to be used for public education. And also the received a resolution from Cindy Ammons, president of the Sanford Area Association of Realtors, supporting the same.
All right.
And I did, I originally said that I did not request the maintenance. I think I did. I'm getting my issues confused, I guess. And while I was out of town Thursday and Friday, I did get the list of the maintenance expenditures and probably make copies and send it to finance. It's a pretty thick document, so everybody can see what they've done for the last 3 years at the schools.
Okay. Anything else?
Yes, sir. We had difficulty trying to get everybody together this week for the retreat, and so at this time we do not have a date to retreat. I guess, you know, from the staff's perspective, you know, if we're going to have that difficulty and we want to have everybody present, what we discussed was just trying to have some a little bit longer discussion at the regular board meetings on issues that the commissioners wanted to discuss, namely our financial position, growth issues, and those were really the two big issues. You know, how we're going to plan for our growth. We have discussed with Don Kovacic and Bob Bridwell, giving us an overview of the growth patterns in the county and where they see things going and how we were going to address that. Also wanted to take a little bit longer discussion this year on the capital improvement plan. I think just from being here, I think some folks, we had put the plan together, had put some expenditures in some years, and I think folks were believing that was a commitment by the board that we were going to work towards trying to fund those projects in those years. And I think we just need to spend a little extra time first with the Finance Committee and then the full board really taking a look at this. Like I said, the total request is over $100 million. And, you know, the the $38 million that the quarter cent sales tax would bring would just put a dent in the request. So I think we really need to take a look at it. The board needs to prioritize and see what we can do with that. And I think the best thing we can do there is if the board would like to, we've tentatively scheduled Davenport to come on the 18th and give us a financial overview and of what our debt capacities are and give some hypothetical situations to us. The number one thing I think everybody needs to remember is that without the quarter cent sales tax, if we keep our tax rate at the current 75 cents, our debt capacity is about $8 million. If we go over $8 million in borrowing, we're going to need to raise property taxes just on the debt. And we have to remember that, and I think we've learned lessons with the high school and the middle school, that whenever we borrow money, there's also a current expense that goes with that, and that also requires a tax increase to go with that. So, I think just some, we need, I think as a group, we need to just get some ideas on where we need to be headed. But at the next meeting, we need to if we're going to move forward with either one of the taxes, we need to pass a resolution authorizing the Board of Education to move forward. And then we need to think about how we're going to go out in the community and sell the tax to the community, or I should say educate the community. Staff can educate, you all can sell. So we've already gotten some PowerPoints and some other presentations from the folks that were successful. There were six counties that have been successful so far, gotten all their ideas. I was at a meeting 2 weeks ago where I gathered all their information, and some of the counties spent quite a bit of money on media campaigns, and then there were some that spent very little, and I think I'm going to advocate the very little expenditures. I think you can get the same result in this county as some of those folks did. I don't think we're a big media market, and I think more the personal education would help us. So I think we have a lot to discuss, and my suggestion is that we just try to do those at the board meetings if we have a difficult time getting together on a retreat day.
Well, we don't necessarily have to do it in an open session or during our meeting. We can adjourn the meeting and possibly go over to the Wicker Room and have the retreat portion of our meeting.
Okay.
Anything else?
I think that's enough.
Okay. Mr. Reeves?
I have a corrected copy of the Finance Committee meeting on January 22nd. I think the others got out prematurely. I'm hoping that won't happen again. I've got a corrected copy. And I'd be happy to know that Finance Committee intends on bringing, as you and Commissioner Lamont has requested, bringing a recommendation for the optional taxes on February 18th. We'll probably meet right before the regular board meeting, Finance Committee will, and bring forth the recommendation during the regular meeting.
Mr. Lamont?
Just a few things here right quick, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank, and I didn't do it last meeting, I forgot about it, but the Medicine Park Pharmacy, I wanted to thank them for the donation that Medicine Park, Barbara and Billy Cameron and Charles and them down there did for the blood pressure cuffs and the glucometers. I asked Mr. Haynes if he would send a letter of appreciation to them for that. Also, I'd like to thank this board for that vote of support for the Hillcrest Youth Center, the Thanks program, the mentoring, and everything like this, because this really benefits the children here in this county. And also, the other night I was, no, the other day I was going out Steel Bridge Road, and I see that the bridge and the roadway has been completely redone out there. The old bridge taken out, the new one put in. Of course, they had to go through a lot of brownstone to get that project done. But I tell you what, to go out there and look at it, you wouldn't believe it. They did a magnificent job on it. John, when we were out there, you wouldn't recognize it. You do. They did a fantastic job on that project. And the last thing I have, Mr. Chairman, in looking at what we had in our package so far as support for, you know, letter of support for other counties involved in the OLF, such as Camden and Gates County. I think this board needs to send a letter of support for that.
You make a motion?
Yes, sir, I will. I'd move to recommend that we support a letter so far as the OLF in the northeastern counties of North Carolina.
Right. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say no. So ordered.
That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Kelly?
Yes. There's been some misinformation recently in the Sanford Herald about this board's actions regarding the scheduling of the vote for alcohol sales. And editorial I read accused this board of poor planning and wasting money by not scheduling the vote during the primary. And Mr. Hull, will you please read North Carolina General Statute and clarify this so our community has the accurate information?
The regulation of alcoholic beverages is controlled by Chapter 18B of the General Statute. We had township elections, and in respect to that, they say that an election may be held in townships where the population of all cities and counties that have previously approved the sale of any kind of alcoholic beverages comprises more than 20% of the total county population as of the most recent federal census. And I think my recollection is that the percentage was 50% in this county. Therefore, we were eligible. And the statute provides the election shall be held by the County Board of Elections upon the request of the Board of Commissioners. And then provision for the General Assembly goes so far and says that the election date, that the Board of Elections shall set a date for the alcoholic beverage election, which may not be sooner than 60 days nor later than 120 days from the date the request was received from the governing body. And no alcoholic beverage election may be held on the Tuesday next after the first Monday in November of an even-numbered year. We took action on November the 5th at your meeting to have them to hold an election. It was sent to them shortly thereafter. And they determined that they were within, they had exceeded the 60 days by scheduling it for January 29th. And that was their election to pick it at that date. And I think they picked a date earlier than the primary because this is a township election, not a precinct election. In the election in the primary, you'll vote by precinct. Of course, we had some difficulty the last time commissioners ran because in some precincts they got mixed up about who lived in what district for commissioners.
Seem to remember that.
So they gave this one. We had seven separate elections, seven township elections. And so they selected a date as they were entitled to.
And that date was within the 60 and 120 days and well before the May primary, right?
Primary would be beyond the 120 days from that.
Thank you for clarifying that.
We, this board had nothing at all to do with setting the date for the election. Is that correct?
That's correct.
We just made a resolution to them.
Board of Elections, within the law, picked the date when we would have it.
We did not specify a date in the resolution.
One other thing has come up. Mr. Bartlett has called the board's attention, the election board's attention, because of the apparent tie in the unofficial returns, and they'll undo that, I guess, tomorrow when they have their canvass. But the General Assembly in 18B-602 goes so far as they say determining results of malt beverage election, and the language for determining the results in a wine election are exactly the same. It says the kind of malt beverage sales or wine sales described in each proposition that receives a majority of votes for shall be allowed. And their ruling was that a tie is a defeat. Statute requires you to get a majority vote before any sale is authorized. And it goes as our unofficial results have been put out. I think in Cape Fear there's three provisional votes they have to pass on. But if it comes up a tie, then that fails to carry the day.
Okay.
John, if you'll get that information back to your editor, I'd appreciate that.
Well, I think the question was, you could have called for the referendum later. You could have called for it in February.
But we didn't set the date. The election board of elections did that. Is that the point you're trying to make?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Anything else?
I'm good.
In light of what Mr. Reeves has just said about the Finance Committee having a resolution for us on the 18th, the only comments I would have is that just in reviewing everything that everyone has said over the last two meetings that I've been at, we've had roughly 32 comments on this, and not one of them has been for the land transfer. And in light of Ms. Minner's presentation, there's not, I think we'd be better served with just a 0.25 sales tax to be put on the ballot. And that's the only comments I have.
Okay, was that what you were?
Yes, that's all I was going to ask.
Ms. Hewitt.
Well, I'm glad that Jamie brought up the thing about the referendum, because somehow or other I was under the impression that we couldn't offer it during a presidential primary. I don't know whether that was something that was mentioned at one of our meetings, but that was my impression all along. So, second thing I want to do is to thank the United Way and the St. Luke's Methodist Church for the grants that were in our consent agenda today. It's nice that we have local nonprofits that will contribute, so I want to give thanks to them. We've heard several comments that people would like to see us meet in the evenings, especially on issues where we're seeking public comments. And I received several phone calls from people who had their ideas on these proposed taxes, and several of them said also they would like to see us, at least one meeting a month, have an evening meeting so working people could come, and I would like for us to consider doing that. And yes, since I'm the new person on the school board, I just need to find out when I can meet with them, because probably these things I've asked you for them to provide, I could get directly now that I'm the late liaison, or?
There's no guarantees. There's no guarantees. You're getting a copy of the recent material.
Those are the maintenance expenditures for Lee Senior.
There's some things that I have, concerns with, and I've been a public educator all my life. But I think we're finding ourselves reacting now to inefficiency and whatever at the state and local level. You know, we're reacting to our huge immigrant population that's here, and that's causing some problems with classroom space and ESL teachers. We're responding to us providing more and more services for instructional needs that really we're not required to spend. And so I think that we just need to take a look at all of that and work together with the school board and put some pressure on the General Assembly to fund what they're supposed to fund, or else remove those unfunded mandates. So hopefully we can work together to solve some of those issues.
Well, I agree with you wholeheartedly, but good luck.
Elections aren't coming up this year. People get tired enough of same old, maybe they'll make some changes.
Those two resolutions that you have, Mr. Crompton, would you restate who they're from?
Mr. Rhodes, President, Sanford Area Home Builders Association, and Cindy Ammons, President, Sanford Area Association of Realtors.
All right, I think we need to have a motion to accept those and make them part of our minutes.
I'd move to do so with the inclusion of one from Mr. George, a letter from Mr. George J. Wilberg, 5021 Simpson Drive. Okay. My interpretation of his letter favors the sale tax.
All right.
So I would move to have all three included.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, say no. It is so ordered. I believe we have taken care of all the business that we have before us today. Our next meeting is scheduled for 3 p.m. on the 18th. And I would assume that after that meeting, we will have our first session of our retreat. Is that correct?
I think we're having public hearings at 7, so.
You mentioned Davenport.
Huh? That's correct. I was just going to make a part of this meeting, starting at 3. I was going to have them, first to make their presentation, because I think they'll probably want to come early and meet with the Finance Committee and then into the regular meeting.
Okay.
So what time is Finance?
Can we say 2?
Can we say 2?
All right. Having concluded all the business, I entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?